Now, gentlemen, you know that our wives are sometimes prone to want to take control of situations.
Really?
Is that, am I speaking the truth?
I didn't know that.
Okay, well, I'm your teacher. That's why I'm here. How old are you going to be next birthday?
Big one.
Big one? Okay, it's never too late to learn then, Matt. So, as we were preparing for Amy and Matthew to come, Lisa, who's a quilter, not a carpenter, is wanting to organize and do what she does best. She has the gift of administration. And so she's wanting to get in there and organize everything. And she's prepared meals in advance, and we thank her for that. But I told her, I said, honey, this is not about a project. It's about a relationship. And whether the project gets finished or we do have two bathrooms, okay? So it's not as grave as I indicated. We have a second bathroom that we're using. I said it's not about whether we finish or not, or whether it looks great or not, although it looks great. It's not about any of that. It's about restoring, not a bathroom, but restoring a relationship. And I think sometimes we forget that, that God's business and what we're going to talk about today seems to be dire and dark, but it's God's attempt, once again, to restore the relationship between He and humankind, between God and His people. And so we're in, so we'll give you a report next week, if I'm here, how the project came out. So tomorrow we're supposed to put the toilet back in, turn the water on, hook the lights up, all that stuff. So you know, pray for us that all goes well. Today we're in Revelation chapter 6. And I'm entitling this chapter 6, Wrath Restrained. Wrath Restrained. And the key verse in this section is where Jesus says that He will only give authority. This is verse 8b. They were given authority over a fourth of the earth to kill with the sword, famine, and pestilence, and by the wild animals of the earth. So I want you to keep that in mind, that the Lord is opening the seals of the scroll, but He's limiting the wrath of God to only one-fourth. He's restraining Himself here. So we see in today's reading, this is New American Standard Version, the first seal, the rider on the white horse. Then I saw when the Lamb broke one of the seven seals, and I heard one of the four living creatures saying as with a voice of thunder, "Come." I looked, and behold, a white horse, and he who sat on it had a bow, and a crown was given to him. And he went out conquering and to conquer. Some of your Bibles may say, "Come see." Does anybody's Bible say "come see" instead of "come"?
Come and see.
Come and see. The commentators and scholars suggest to us that "come see" is not quite right. That this is not for us to see. It's actually a call from the Lord, a call out for these horses and riders to come onto the earth. And so what we're seeing here is the scroll open and a call from the four living creatures, which we'll talk about again, for these horsemen to come into the earth, to invade history. And the period that we're talking about is the end times, the end of history. So it's come and go into the world. Second seal, war. When he broke the second seal, I heard the second living creature saying, "Come." And another, a red horse, went out, and to him who sat on it, it was granted to take peace from the earth, and that men would slay one another, and a great sword was given to him. The third seal, famine. When he broke the third seal, I heard the third living creature saying, "Come." I looked, and behold, a black horse, and he who sat on it had a pair of scales in his hand. And I heard something like a voice in the center of the four living creatures saying, "A quart of wheat for a denarius, and 3 quarts of barley for a denarius, and do not damage the oil and the wine." The fourth seal, death. When the Lamb broke the fourth seal, I heard the voice of the fourth living creature saying, "Come." And I looked, and behold, an ashen horse, and he who sat on it had the name Death, and Hades was following him. Authority was given to them over a fourth of the earth to kill with sword and with famine and with pestilence and the wild beast of the earth. Now this is a depressing scene, not to be confused with the four horsemen of the apocalypse known at Notre Dame. Does anybody remember that one? Huh? If I said that to young people, they'd go, "What?" Newt Rockne, right? Newt Rockne, famous coach. He had a group of players that was so bad, you know, so good, bad, tough guys, that they were called four horsemen of the apocalypse. So this is a terrible vision of what is to come and what is, in fact, as we will see today, happening even in our time. So let's talk about what these images mean. And we have to ground our understanding in something that our dear teacher Bill Urey taught many years ago and many times, and that we've talked about since I've been teaching. And that is, to understand any scripture, but especially this scripture, we have to be reminded of the character of God. And God's essential character is holiness and love. And we find those themes repeated over and over throughout Scripture. So God is holy. 1 Peter 1:16 reminds us of the Old Testament teachings from the Pentateuch, that because God is holy, who is called to be holy? We are called to be holy. And so holiness is an essential character of God, and this holiness causes Him to hate sin and disobedience. And because He is holy, He is entitled to judge and render judgments. And we read last time and over the several weeks, who is worthy to judge the earth? Only the Lamb of God, Jesus, because He was perfectly holy. This judgment issues forth in the need to seek justice. And one of the themes throughout Revelation, and we'll see it next week, is the saints of God, the Christians who have been martyred, and those of us even today, cry out for what? For good to triumph over evil, and for justice to be done, and for those who have wronged God to get their right reward. So justice is what this holy God does. And the way that justice happens is through wrath. And we see that throughout the Old Testament. God is patient, but there comes a point, as we know as parents, where what? Or as employers, or as teachers, our wrath cannot be restrained anymore. And that's when the belt came out in my house. Not in my house, but in my Father's house. The belt came out. The restraint was lifted, and I was whipped. Okay? Many of you probably were too. The wrath of Coach Henderson, I'll never forget it. I was in 7th or 8th grade, middle school, and I don't remember what I did, but I remember the wrath of Coach Henderson. It was unrestrained because he called me into his office and I had gym shorts on and just a jock strap and gym shorts. And Coach Henderson had paddles hanging behind his desk that were made in shop class by victims of his wrath, gentlemen, if you remember that. So, being a clever young fellow, I tried to pick the paddle that would inflict the least pain. I picked the one with holes in it, which had been drilled on the drill press that I and myself had used before. So Coach Henderson said, bend over. He gave me my punishment, right? I can tell you a paddle with holes is the wrong choice. Exactly. But I never did whatever it was I did again. So this wrath that comes from the holiness of God is a consequence of sin. And we tend to think of sin individually. But in Revelation and in the entire Scripture, in fact, we see the sins of communities and nations being acted out and causing all manner of consequences to humankind. And then we have the God that we like, this God. We don't like this God. The one that we like and the one that the popular culture talks about is this love God. And in contrast to hating sin and disobedience, God's character of love, we have Scripture that tells us, for God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever should believe in Him shall not perish, but shall have eternal life. And we have a common saying, God hates sin, but He loves the sinner. And that's this conflict, or this the thing that the culture can't understand, is how a God could hate sin and yet love the sinner. The culture wants to proclaim this message: God loves the sinner, so all y'all should love what? The sinner's sins. And we should affirm the sins in our culture and now in the church. This love, judgment, is offset by His compassion. And we've heard two witnesses today of God's compassion. We can't understand it. We don't know exactly how it happened. But the McDaniel family and the Russ family and the Book family, and I don't know the names of your granddaughter, the Booth. Pool family are rejoicing at God's compassion for us this day. And this is where grace comes from, all the way to the point where God gave His Son for us. And that is the person who is opening these scrolls today. We receive His mercy, and as a consequence of our repentance, we have eternal life. So it's this God, holiness and love. The wrath is coming from holiness. The restraint is coming from His love. Now, God could have told these four horsemen what? Newt Rockne, I'm sure, said, run up the score, boys. God could have said, not just a quarter of the earth, but half the earth, or three quarters of the earth, or the entire earth, destroy it all. I've had enough. And yet we see in verse 8b that he restrains this wrath. So the question is, why restrain the wrath? So here we have Revelation 6, 1 and 2. This imagery is of military conquest. And we have the lion, the first creature, first of the four creatures. And remember, those creatures represent all of creation, represent characteristics of God on this earth. So we have the lion, symbol of majesty and power, being announcing the white horse. And in biblical times, the white horse was a symbol of victory. And in fact, emperors and generals, when they won a great victory, they would ride in on a white horse. I think USC's the Trojan. Does he ride a white horse?
Yes.
Does he? Okay, well, that's a... We don't connect those things, but that's a modern symbol that goes all the way back to ancient times. And the bow, the rider has a bow, which is a symbol of military power. And in fact, just about 30 years before these events are recorded by John in Revelation, the Roman army, which was thought to be invincible, surrendered to the Parthians, who were the people from the east, would be from modern-day Iran area. These Parthians were famous for their archery skills on horseback. And they rode, historians tell us that they rode white horses. So we have a scene here of military conquest and victory. And that victory is assured. And I think the lesson here is that God's wrath can be restrained by God, but in the end it can't be thwarted. Nothing that we do when He decides to let it go can restrain it. And think about Jerusalem circa 70 AD, which these people living at this time would have known what happened to Jerusalem. So what happened to Jerusalem?
Destroyed.
Completely destroyed by the Roman general, later Emperor Titus. And the temple was destroyed stone by stone. And who has seen those stones laying on the ground? Okay, many of us have seen those stones. And so that is the imagery of wrath unleashed. This is a famous picture of our own time. And probably we're numb to this kind of stuff now. We see it too often. But look, the little boy was the one who was mostly shown. But look, sitting next to him, there's a little girl. Okay? These are victims of the bombing of Aleppo by the Russians. I hope we're not bombing Aleppo ourselves, but we're bombing some other places. So here is the consequence of war, which is horrific to us. And what is God's, what should our response be to this? That's the question of Revelation 6. Because these events, while they are in the future, remember, God restrains His wrath, and so He gives us pieces of this. What happened after 9/11 in churches throughout this land? I assume we weren't here, but I assume it happened in this church.
So they set aside time to pray. Pray as a nation.
What happened to attendance? Attendance go up? Okay. Hurricane Katrina. What happened to attendance? Attendance go up. I don't remember when Pearl Harbor was bombed. And I'm not asking if any of you remember it. Max. But what do you think happened when Pearl Harbor was bombed? church attendance increase. And we could go back to significant local events, earthquakes, floods, the Great Depression, etc. And I bet church attendance went up. That gives us a glimpse as to why God would allow His wrath to unfold, even in the face of the fact that He loves His people. He loves all of humankind. And that wrath is intended to get us to repent. And so when we see pictures like this, because this is in Syria, it doesn't bother us that much. We become numb to it, as I said. But if it happens in our family, or it happens in our community, or it happens in our nation, what then? Next, we have Revelation 6, 3, and 4, war. Bitter hatred. War occurs when we have bitter hatred. We had a great civil war in our country in which brother fought against brother, bitter hatred between the North and the South. Same thing going on in Syria. This is the famous picture that Picasso painted of Guernica, a town in Spain. And this was during the period of the Spanish Civil War in the 1930s, prior to World War II. And we'll talk about this picture in a minute. This announcement is coming from the ox, the creature, second creature, the ox, who is a symbol of faithfulness. And the ox says, "Come forth." The blood-red horse, which is a symbol of destruction, the destruction of war, man fighting against man, and nation against nation. Somebody turn to Isaiah 19:2 and read for us. This is an oracle concerning this sequence in Isaiah's oracles about surrounding countries to Israel and the wrath that they will receive for opposing Israel. And start at 19:1 to 19:4.
The burden against Egypt is the title of the heading. Behold, the Lord rides on a swift cloud and will come into Egypt. The idols of Egypt will totter at His presence, and the heart of Egypt will melt in its midst. I will set Egyptians against Egyptians. Everyone will fight against his brother, and everyone against his neighbor, city against city, kingdom against kingdom. The spirit of Egypt will fail in its midst. I will destroy their counsel, and they will consult the idols and the charmers, the mediums and the sorcerers. And the Egyptians I will give into the hand of a cruel master, and a fierce king will rule over them, says the Lord of hosts.
Okay, so this particular wrath is setting people, in this case Egyptians, against each other. So division is what happens with this particular, and there are many other scriptures. Zechariah 14:13. Somebody turn to that and read that one for us.
On that day, people will be stricken by the Lord with great panic. They will seize each other by the hand and attack one another.
Okay, even Judah will fight at Jerusalem. The wealth of all the surrounding nations will be collected, gold, silver, garments in great abundance. Plague like this plague shall fall on the horses and mules. Again, apocalyptic scenery. We have in our country this phenomenon, neighbor turning against neighbor. We call it tweeting. Okay? We call it identity politics. Identity politics is very dangerous. Tweeting ugly things about people, I don't tweet. I'm not on social media. I don't recommend it. Okay, maybe from the devil. I'm not sure. Okay? That might be my theme for this year. I've about exhausted football, right? So my theme this year may be social media. Beware social media. But here we have embittered hatred. And the question is, how can a holy, loving God unleash this wrath? How can a holy, loving God cause neighbor to fight neighbor? Does that make any sense? This is why the culture gets confused by our strange Christian faith. How can a holy and loving God set neighbor against neighbor? Did that come from God?
No.
Did that come from God's character? Where did it come from? The evil one. And remember in Galatians 5, before the fruit of the Spirit, we have the fruit of the flesh. Jealousy, envy, strife, division. So this wrath, this second wrath, is simply God turning us over to who?
Ourselves.
To ourselves. He's simply saying, okay, you all want to go your own way and you don't want to trust me personally, in your family, in your community, in your business, in your nation. You don't want to trust me? Check this out. So who has been to the Prado in Madrid and seen this? It's shocking when you see it. Lisa and I went there some years ago. And it's a mural. It's a giant wall. And I picked the color version. It's black and white. But I picked the color version because we can see some things in this painting. The setting is 1937. Franco, the dictator of Spain, is fighting communist forces. And Hitler is on the side of Franco. And the Germans are trying to prove and test their air power with the new Stuka dive bombers. Does that sound familiar today? Do we have a nation testing its air power on a weak, defenseless country? Syria? So notice that you have anguished, disembodied people. Here's part of an arm. Here's a cut-off head, and there's all kinds of symbolism of chaos and death and destruction. But what stood out to me is you have what appears to be a light up here, a sun, a light. You have a horse right here, and you have a creature that has the stripes of a lion and an ear, but the horns of what? An ox. Okay? I don't know if Picasso meant to have this imagery in here, but where do we see a lion and an ox? In this book that we're studying. So here we have an image of the chaos, the death, the destruction. We have flames of fire. And look at this. Remember, I don't know if that's looks more like a duck than an eagle, but at least it's a bird. So remember, our four creatures are a lion, an ox, a human, and an eagle, all of which we might see in this painting. And so even Picasso, I'm pretty certain, was not a Christian. But he uses the imagery of Revelation to depict that in fact God's wrath in small ways is being unfolded even as we speak.
Well, Randy, what started, what was the cause? This was a civil war, though. wasn't it? It was the Spanish Civil War.
Yeah, remember during this period, you had competing forces between the communists. Remember the Russian Revolution, 1917. So we're 20 years on from the Russian Revolution. The Soviet state is set up. Communism is becoming the big enemy. So we have fascism or national socialism, Nazi, that's where we get the word Nazi. Fascism and communism are competing in Europe for power and control. And so you have a civil war in Spain, had one in Greece, there was one in Germany. We don't recognize it as such because the Nazis put it down so fast. So that's the backdrop, is fascist, national socialist competing against the communists. And today we would recognize national socialism. We don't call it this, and I don't want to be too controversial, but it would be progressivism, national socialism. And we see where that ends. Hitler. Or Mussolini or Hirohito. So it's very dangerous. So this picture is of the strong Nazi Luftwaffe bombing poor Spanish villages in an attempt to keep or to have a dictator in power. And Franco, interestingly enough, ruled until 1975, if you remember that. So he was the last dictator of World War II. He stayed in power for a long time, unlike Mussolini and Hitler. We know they were dead after the war. Did I answer your question, Jerry?
Yes, uh-huh.
Verse 6, 5, and
6,
famine and luxury. And this bears a little bit of, I'm looking at the wrong clock here. So this bears just a brief discussion. A quart of wheat for a day's pay and 3 quarts of barley for a day's pay. Food, basic food is very expensive, but do not damage olive oil and wine. The picture here is of luxury, availability of luxury goods, but not enough food for the average person. And so here we have the human representing God's intelligence, creative ability, the black horse representing both famine and luxury, and Ezekiel 4:16 is the verse that I want to refer us to, and I'll turn to that real quick. Then he said to me, "See, I will let you have cow's dung instead of human dung on which to prepare your bread." Then he said to me, "Mortal, I am going to break the staff of bread in Jerusalem. They shall eat bread by weight, and with fearlessness they shall drink water by measure and in dismay. Lacking bread and water, they will look at one another in dismay and waste away under their punishment." So this wrath, Ezekiel and others talk about, is one of famine while those in power live in what way? In luxury. So necessities, in this case corn, will be scarce, but luxury abounds. In the times of Nero and Domitian, there were famines. Domitian is the emperor of the Revelation. There were famines in Italy, and the historians tell us that a boat came from the Middle East where they were growing food, and the boat, people showed up to the boat because they thought it was corn. It was sand for the arena. The arena needed a particular type of fine sand. I guess we'd call it Pensacola Beach sand. So the ship comes, the people are all there waiting for what they thought was food, And it was saying, riots ensued. So for the luxury of the arena and the sport, the emperor spent money, but they wouldn't spend money on corn. And so this is economic injustice. This is a picture from within the last 10 years of children in North Korea. And we know that famine, starvation, forced starvation is used as a political tool in North Korea. And there's the leader of North Korea. He doesn't look slim. Okay? And finally, we have death and pestilence, the eagle, which is God's sovereignty, a pale horse, death and disease, followed by hell, and this is the wrath for the disobedient. In the case, for the sake of time, we won't go to Ezekiel and Leviticus. I'll take that up next week. But what we can say about these troubling verses is that no one can escape the consequences of sin and the wrath of God without the saving grace of Jesus Christ. And so God has restrained His wrath in order for people in the world to come to know Him. So even in wrath, He wants repentance so that people will be saved for all eternity. Next week, we'll talk about the fifth and sixth seal, and this is one of the most beautiful sections in all of Scripture, where the saints, the martyrs who are underneath the altar, are crying out, "How long, Lord? How long before we will see justice?" And so next week we'll conclude chapter 6. Let us pray. Good and gracious Heavenly Father, we thank You for John's faithfulness in being open to Your Spirit to receive this word and these visions, which seem on the surface to be troubling, that You would unleash wrath to destroy one quarter of the earth and its people. But we know, Lord, that that wrath comes from Your holiness, but that You are also love, and that all people have the way out to avoid this wrath for eternity and to live in right relationship with You. We pray that as we experience wrath in our own personal lives, in our families, in our communities, in our nation, and between nations, that You would call each of us and those that we influence to repentance and saving faith in You. For it is then that we can claim to be in right relationship and to live with You and enjoy Your pleasure forever and ever. We pray most humbly in the Lamb who is worthy to open these scrolls, Jesus the Christ. Amen.